All right, hi everyone. Thank you for having me here. As we just told, my name's Amber. This work has been done jointly together with my supervisor, Luca Allodi, at Eindhoven University of Technology. Many organizations have a customer base that suffers from being targeted by phishing attacks. And often these organizations operate a phishing abuse inbox to which these customers can forward these emails that they suspect of being malicious. So this allows the organization to respond to these emails and investigate what kind of malicious links are in there, see what kind of phishing landing pages these redirect to, and if this email is a particularly threatening one, they can decide to submit a domain takedown request to take the phishing landing page offline, which is often performed by a third party. So these tests are generally being performed on a first-come, first-served basis. But for organizations receiving thousands or tens of thousands of these notifications per month, this process doesn't scale. So ideally, we would have some kind of metric to prioritize among the incoming phishing emails that are most likely to pose a threat to the organization. And by a threat or a dangerous email, we mean an email that is most likely to generate a click in the recipients. So we can stop spending time doing all these extensive manual investigations. So luckily, the social engineering principles on which these emails rely to influence the recipients to take an action are based on some fundamental vulnerabilities in human decision making, which have been extensively studied in the cognitive psychology literature, which allows us to use these existing theories on human persuasion as a framework towards developing a method to measure these informational cues present in the phishing that are indicative of such attacks, and then using these measurements towards predicting just how successful a given phishing attack can be expected to be even before the clicks happen, or how high in the remediation priority queue it should be. So as opposed to building a classifier that detects phishing, we are here focusing on the malicious content embedded in the text itself to improve response capabilities. So our cognitive psychology framework on human decision making describes six of these principles of human influence that account for the persuasion of people. I will go through each of them very briefly. So the first one is social proof, stating that people tend to act similarly to peers to fit in. In a phishing email, this may be reflected by having the attacker state that this is not just an action that you have to do, but something that your friends, neighbors, or colleagues have already done so. Second, consistency, that people tend to be consistent with previous decisions they made. So if someone makes a voluntary public commitment, they will probably follow through on that in their future actions. Third, reciprocity. People form implied or explicit obligations towards one another. Receiving a favor from someone makes you more likely to return a favor at a later moment in time. Fourth, liking. People are more likely to trust people that they like, find convincing, attractive, or that they perceive to be similar as themselves. Fifth, authority. People are sensitive to authority and they also fear punishment. So this makes them more likely to comply to the requests of people that are in authoritative positions, which is also commonly reflected in phishing emails, as these are often signed by some kind of fictional CEO, CFO, or anyone else in such a higher position. And the sixth one, scarcity. So people will react quickly and possibly irrationally when the cost of waiting is high, which is also commonly seen in phishing emails stating that someone has to perform this certain action within X days or X hours, or for instance, your account will be locked out. So building on these theories, we made the following plan towards developing a method to predict just how effective a given phishing email is expected to be. But first we needed data, and in our case we consider the number of clicks associated with a phishing email to be a reasonable measure of how effective that attack has been. So we require a data set that has a clear connection between these two factors. Then we take a natural language processing approach towards automated measurement of the cognitive vulnerabilities present in the email bodies, and then state that phishing success is a function of the intensity of the cognitive vulnerabilities exploited therein, And we relate these previously obtained measurements on the presence of those measurements on the presence of the vulnerability triggers in the email bodies to how many clicks were generated. And then based on this relation, we develop a regression model to predict the number of clicks that could be expected to be generated by previously unseen emails, which effectively then allows us to establish a triaging mechanism for these emails. So luckily, we were able to get access to a data set of over 90,000 phishing emails supplied by a large European bank with over 9 million clients globally. So they urged their customers to forward any emails they suspect of being phishing to their phishing abuse inbox. And these emails generally contain a link that leads to a phishing landing page. Conveniently, these landing pages often pull resources from the organization's legitimate domain, like logos or other branded images. The organization has a user session monitoring in place, which records all web traffic going towards their domains. So each time someone clicks a phishing landing page, pulling those resources from their own organizational domain, a click is recorded for that phishing landing page. By tracing the URL then contained in the phishing from the organization's abuse inbox to the URLs for which the organization has recorded a click, we now have a reasonable connection between the phishing emails in our data set and the number of clicks these have generated, allowing us to use this as a measure of how successful the phishing has been. One complication of our data set is, of course, that multiple customers can forward the same phishing email to the abuse inbox, often changing the subject line, but also adding some minor personal commentary to the email body. So we identified duplicates in our data set using a cosine similarity metric and grouped these all to the same campaigns. In the figure, you can see an overview of the similarity of samples of emails from each different observation week. So for each different week, we took a random sample of emails where each pixel in the graph represents the similarity between two emails received in different weeks. The darker the color in the figure, the more similarity between the samples. So obviously, all parts on the diagonal are dark. What is interesting is that we can see high similarity measures for samples outside of the diagonal area as well. For instance, the red square indicates that emails received in week 26 are textually quite similar to emails from week 21, indicating perhaps that an attacker reused a slightly modified version of their original phishing email. So overall, we can see that it takes approximately 4 to 6 weeks before such campaigns reappear in our observation period, which could also be an indication of another evasion technique implemented by attackers. We took a closer look at these campaigns we identified, and as shown in the left picture, we found that single-day campaigns were relatively common, accounting for almost 25% of all campaigns, but also that a relatively large portion of attacks last over a much longer period, with the average campaign lasting around 150 days, indicating that attacks are either very quick or last for much longer periods. Also, for each of the sender domains in the campaign's email from headers, we determined to what extent these domains were spoofed or how similar they were to the organization's original sender domain. We did this by calculating the Liebenstein distance, which is the minimum number of single character edits that are required to transform the one string into the other. The right figure shows how this relation changes over time, with higher values on the y-axis indicating a greater dissimilarity between the domains, and showing us that as the campaigns advance, the phishing sender domains become less similar to the organization's legitimate domain. And this is in line with the intuition that spoof domains are limited in number, and attackers may therefore run out of options as more similar sending domains get blacklisted as the campaign progresses. Now, this probably also means that even though the attackers are recycling the same email contents, this campaign could be much less effective near the end of the campaign with a not so well spoofed sender domain compared to when it was originally launched. So knowing this, we formally explored the relation between the degree of spoofing in the sender domain of the phishing and the number of clicks that were generated for phishing emails for which we had this feature recorded. So the x-axis again shows the Liebenstein distance in relation to the generated number of clicks on the y-axis on a log scale, where dots on the left of the graph represent better spoofed emails than those more to the right, showing us the effect that attacks with more similarity between the phishing sender domain and the official domain of the organization are more effective in generating a response from the phishing recipient. Now, having a much better understanding of what our data looks like, we could start building our prediction model. So first, we manually labeled a set of phishing mails for the presence of each of the six cognitive vulnerabilities and use it as our training set to construct a word topic model. This topic model provides us with a word topic distribution that describes for each of the cognitive vulnerabilities which word triggers are most likely to appear in emails that exploit such a vulnerability. This allows us to infer a binary measure of which cognitive vulnerabilities are exploited, but also a measure of the intensity with which the vulnerability has been exploited. So more vulnerability triggers indicate a higher chance of successful exploitation. We run this word topic model on the remainder of our original phishing data set, including the emails for which we have recorded how many clicks they generated, to measure the cognitive attacks present therein. And in parallel, we perform a regression on recorded click counts and estimate a model to predict how many clicks could have been generated by emails with similar distributions of vulnerability triggers in the email body. Then, after careful selection of our final regression model, we run this on the full set of previously unseen emails, for which we now have cognitive measurements to predict how many clicks these emails could be expected to generate. It may be more intuitive to see an example of how the word topic model could assist us in measuring which cognitive vulnerabilities have been exploited. So on this slide, I'm showing you a translated example of a phishing email after tagging, in which the attacker is stating that the organization is releasing a new debit card, which requires the customer to sign up to receive this new card and recycle the old one. So on the left side, you can see the different topics that correspond to the vulnerabilities and the specific word triggers that are associated with the specific exploitation of them. So we can see, for instance, that the words highlighted in yellow are all related to the principle of liking, stating that you are a valuable customer and mentioning recycling and environmental friendliness to make the organization appear more similar to the actual recipient of the email. And similarly, the words highlighted in red refer to legislations and regulations that require the organization to perform this change, which is, of course, to express some form of authority. And it also mentions that if the customer does not perform this action before a certain date, they will be financially punished, as indicated by the words highlighted in gray, and of course, which is referring to the principle of scarcity. So this allows us to see how the tagging of the algorithm can aid us in assessing the specific intensity with which a vulnerability is being exploited by considering the frequencies of words related to each individual vulnerability. Now, having these measurements available for a full data set alongside a measurement of effectiveness in the sense of how many clicks certain emails generated, we can take a closer look to see whether the frequency of triggers for the different vulnerabilities individually exercise any effect on the number of clicks generated. We observe a clear positive effect in line with our hypothesis for triggers of consistency, scarcity, and authority, although this last relation is driven by only a few non-zero data points. However, we also find a negative effect for reciprocity, whereas social proof and liking show no clear effect at all. These differences could be explained by the specific application domain, as corporate customers subject to financial threats from phishing could be expected to have different sensitivity to specific principles of influence than other groups. However, we have no definite conclusion on why reciprocity shows a counterproductive effect. So its presence is making people less likely to click, but considering the perhaps untrustworthy image that banks have, a bank providing its customers with a favor is interpreted by people as a clear sign that something dodgy could be going on. However, generally, these findings do indicate to us that perhaps authority, social proof, and liking are vulnerabilities that could be considered to be less relevant in our scenario. So we can now perform a regression on the previously found cognitive features of the phishing email and how many clicks they generated. We kept two different regression variations, the first shown on the left, including the features of spoofing distance and only the three cognitive vulnerabilities we found to be relevant, so excluding authority, social proof, and liking. And second, on the right, including again the spoofing distance and all the six cognitive vulnerabilities this time. So the figures on the slide show how our models predict how many clicks were generated on input of unseen emails. The black portions of the histograms indicate the top 10% of emails in terms of how effective they are expected to be. So we can see that this fraction of emails is in fact expected to be up to 2 to 4 times as effective as the bulk of emails. So now the cool thing is that this allows us to provide in a fully automated way a manner of targeting first the emails that are most likely to engage a user in compliant behavior. So allowing the organization to triage this stream of incoming phishing attacks to minimize the impact and to spend less time on response. So in this way, by addressing the small fraction of emails associated with the highest expected click counts, one can mitigate a large fraction of potential attacks. Of course, we are now exploring different ways forward towards effectively operationalizing this design, but we are open to exploring other avenues as well. So please get in touch with us if you have any interesting thoughts, and thank you for being here.
All right, thank you for the talk. A few minutes for questions. Question? No. Okay. I'd like to know. You in the training data, it looks like you looked at emails that were reported in the organizations. Did those tend to be high precision, or did you have to do some kind of cleaning of that data?
No, we had to do some cleaning. So sometimes people reported all kinds of other types of spam. But what we mostly did and what worked for us was looking at the links embedded in there. So if an email contained a link to a non-general purpose domain, such as Google or YouTube, so anything else, we considered it to be actually suspicious. And that turned out to be pretty confident in that.
Okay, thank you.
Hi. I'm Igor from Samsung. Really nice talk. Congratulations. I'm wondering if such approach could be applied to detect, for instance, fake news because of the influence. And what do you think about that?
That's an interesting topic, perhaps. Of course, natural language processing could be applied to that too, to see what kind of fake messages they're trying to give across. But it's definitely something that someone else could look into. Thanks.
Okay, let's thank the speaker again.